All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to First Baptist Church. My name is Drake. I'm the senior pastor here, and if you're a guest with us, thank you for joining us. We are glad that you're here. If you're a member, thank you also for joining us. We also live stream our services. We do a radio broadcast, so we want to welcome those as well who are joining us on our live stream and through radio. Hey, we always begin each morning with a scripture passage to direct our thoughts and our minds to the reason and the purpose that we have gathered today. This morning, we are going to look at Malachi chapter 1, verse 11. The author writes, "For from the rising of the sun to its setting, God said, my name will be great among the nations. And in every place, incense will be offered to my name and a pure offering. For my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts." So from the rising of the sun, Malachi said, until the sun sets, God said, my name will be great. Not, I hope my name will be made great, not this is kind of the goal, is that my name will be great, but God said, my name will be made great. And we gather on Sundays as a body of believers, as church members, to join God in making his name great. This is what he's called us to do, is to glorify him. And we do that a number of ways here. We do that, as you see, through song. We do it through prayer, through fellowship, through the preaching of God's word. We even have nursery for children, children's church. We have audiovisual ushers, security, greeting. All of these we gather together to make God's name great among the nations. But we need help. So this morning, let's go to God in prayer and let's ask him for help as we seek to glorify him today here at First Baptist Church. Will you bow your head with me as we pray? Father, we thank you for your word. And Malachi just told us, from the rising of the sun till the setting of the sun, your name will be great among the nations. God, I pray that you will help us today. Help us as we sing songs about you. Help us to glorify you as we sing songs. Help us to glorify you in our praying. Help us to glorify you through our giving, through the nursery, through children's church, through the preaching of your word. God, may all that's said and done today be for your glory. And God, I pray today that as we hear your word and as we seek to make your name great, that you will also lead us as we respond to your spirit. Father, may your spirit go through each pew, through each individual today. God, for those who are saved, may you show us, Father, through your word, how we can glorify you. And for those who are not Christians, God, I pray today that your spirit will open their eyes and help them see how great you are. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Hey, church family, let's stand together and let's make God great among the nations.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance.
Stand in your love, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
shake, crash into the sea. When the oceans roar their troubled song, when the nations rage, when there is no peace, and the cries of war are loud and strong, we will not be moved, we will not be shaken. Kings and kingdoms fall, but the Lord our God will reign forever, sovereign over all. The Lord our God will reign. Stand on your faithfulness. Everything unknown is in your hands. You have overcome every enemy. You have vanquished death by your command. We will not be moved. We will not. Jesus, the Lord of all, we put our trust in you. You hold the whole world in your hands. Sing, oh God. Oh God, you are our God. We put our trust in you. Jesus, the Lord of all, we put our trust in you. You hold the whole world in your hands. You hold the whole world.
Father, we thank you for this day that we have to come and be together in your house, Lord. We pray for Drake as he brings the message to us. Give him the words that you would have him speak to us and make our hearts attentive so that we would listen. Lord, we pray for those that can't be with us today for whatever reason, whether it's traveling. If that's the case, we pray for safety. If it's because they're sick, you would bring healing and just whatever situation keeps them from us, Lord. We pray that you would be with it. Lord, we pray for the ministries of this church. We pray that as we minister to the community as well as to the larger world, that you would bless our efforts and cause them to bear fruit for you. And Lord, we pray for this offering. We pray that it would be used to further your kingdom and that you would bless both the giver and the gift. Ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you.
right, if you are a child, ages, where are we at? 5 years. 5 years old to third grade. There we go. Thank you, Vanessa. You are dismissed for children's church. 5 years old to third grade. And as they are leaving, will you join me in prayer at this time? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can come before your throne. You are the sovereign king of the universe, the sovereign ruler over all things. And it's the song we just sang is that you are sovereign over all. Yet, you invite us to come before your throne in prayer. God, I reflect back on the service. Just here within the first 20 minutes of our gathering together, we've come before your throne 3 times. Yet, you're not annoyed when we come before your throne. We don't bother you. God, you're not too busy. You invite us before your throne, and you are glorified as we pray. Father, I echo what James just prayed, that you will direct our thoughts, our mind, our attention to your inspired, your breathed out word. God, I pray that you will eliminate distractions, whether external or internal. God, I pray that your name will be made great among the nations. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, well, we have come to our end of our journey. We've come to the end, not our end. We've came to the end of our journey in the book of Colossians, this letter that Paul wrote to the church at Colossae. So since the very first Sunday this year, back at the first Sunday in January, we have been talking about spiritual growth, spiritual strength in our own walk with the Lord. If you recall, I didn't want to assume this year that everyone that attends our service or everyone watching online, I didn't want to assume that everybody knows how to read your Bible or everybody knows how to pray, or to have our mind disciplined to think on God and on His Word. So we looked at Colossians. Epaphras taught the people in Colossae how to walk with the Lord, how to be rooted and grounded in the faith. So we've taken a few weeks to do just that, to do something similar here. And if you slept since then, or if this is your first time joining us in this sermon series, let's do a quick recap. Our first Sunday this year, we talked about the preeminence of Jesus. And someone shouted out, what does preeminence mean? First. That's right. All right. A lot of you did. So that's exciting. That Jesus is first. Not only first in all creation, but Jesus is first. He is preeminent in our spiritual growth. We looked at the process of spiritual growth. I talked about the discipline of your mind, and we saw the results of Colossians 3. As your mind is disciplined, your thoughts are set on Christ. We saw that when that happens, it transforms your marriage, it transforms your work, it transforms your parenting, transforms your relationship with others when your mind is set on Christ. So today, if you will take your copy of God's Word out, we're going to look at the last chapter, Colossians chapter 4, as we end our journey. And we've looked at a lot. But today, I want us to direct our thoughts on endurance, or spiritual endurance, if you will. How do we endure in spiritual growth? New Year's resolutions, people typically say, ends around the mid part of January. It takes somewhere between 21 days to 90 days to set a habit, new habit. So how do we endure in spiritual growth? Will you stand with me today as we look at Colossians chapter 4, Before we get into Colossians 4, the previous page, we're going to begin today by looking at Colossians 2, 6, and 7. This has been our theme verse this month. Paul writes, "Therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving." Colossians chapter 4, verse 2, Paul continues, "Continue," verse 2, "steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear," which is how I ought to speak. "Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person." Verse 7, Tychicus, it's a fun name. "Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts, and with him Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him, and Jesus, who is called Justice. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and to Nympha in the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans. And see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord." Last verse in Colossians, Paul said, "I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you." You may be seated. There was a lady by the name of Ann Steele. Ann Steele was born in 1717. She died in the year 1778. At the age of 3 years old, Anne Steele's mother passed away. When Anne became a teenager, she was kicked off of a horse, injured her right hip, and left her disabled the rest of her life. At the age of 19 years old, Anne Steele was engaged. On the day of her wedding, her fiancé was tragically killed. At the age of 43, Anne Steele's sister-in-law passed away. At the age of 45, her mother-in-law passed away. Anne Steele was a caretaker for her father until her father's death. Through all of this tragedy, Anne Steele wrote these words. She wrote, "Father, whatever of earthly bliss thy sovereign will denies, accepted at your throne of grace, let this petition rise. Give me a calm, thankful heart, from every murmur free. Thy blessings of thy grace impart, and make me live to thee." Anne Steele would go on to write over 70 additional songs that many people sing today. Now, facing struggle and heartache after heartache through all of her life, how did Anne endure in her faith in God? I think we not only have the answer here in the words that I just read to you today, but I think we also have the answer in how these words are written. These words were written as a prayer. She used the word petition. Let this petition rise. Today, as we finish our journey on spiritual strength, spiritual growth, I want us to end today with the subject or the topic of prayer. Prayer. God's blessed us with so many different means for us to grow in our faith. I haven't talked about fasting yet. I haven't talked about scripture memory, memorizing the Bible. I haven't talked about that much. I haven't talked about public worship and even private worship. I haven't talked about meditation or evangelism. That's a way that you can grow in the faith. I haven't talked about fellowship. We all like fellowship and others. But in order for you and I to endure in our faith, in order for you and I to endure through the concerns, through the difficulties, through the anxiety, through the joy, through the worries and the concerns, God invites you and I to join in prayer and to endure in prayer. So today, I want us to look at three ways our spiritual strength endures with prayer. Okay? The first way is this. Spiritual strength endures with prayer when we are devoted to prayer. Today, we're going to look at verse 2 alone. That's the only verse we're going to look at. Colossians 4, verse 2. The first four words that Paul writes here in verse 2 is continue steadfastly in prayer. Now, we all know what the word continue means, right? Continue means to press on, to persevere. And Paul didn't simply write continue in prayer. Paul used another word. He said continue steadfastly in prayer. What Paul is meaning here is this means to glue ourselves to prayer. No matter the situation you face. So to continue steadfastly means to glue yourself to prayer. No matter the situation you face. This word glue. Glue yourselves to prayer. If you remember, we spent the majority of 2021 on Sunday mornings in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 1, as Jesus ascended into the heavens, the disciples, the 120 at that time, went back to Jerusalem, met in an upper room, and we learned that they glued themselves to prayer as Jesus went away. And even as we journeyed through Acts, we saw when their persecution arose, when difficulties came, they continued steadfastly. They had glued themselves to prayer. Another example of someone who is devoted to prayer, someone who glued themselves to prayer, Jesus. We know that the Bible teaches Jesus was God's son. He is God's son. He came to this earth to redeem us, but one commentary stated that the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, recorded over 35 times that Jesus prayed. So if the one who came to redeem us from our sin, to save us from an eternal hell, and is the very Son of God, if he devoted himself to prayer, if the apostles, the early church throughout the book of Acts, if they glued themselves to prayer in prayer today, we are not off the hook, my friends. The Holy Spirit commands us here in Colossians 4 to continue steadfastly in prayer. Glue yourselves to prayer, no matter the situation you're facing. But why would Paul end this letter to the church at Colossae with instruction to pray? He's talked about the preeminence of Christ. He spoke about the words of Jesus dwelling in you. He talked about the radical change that takes place when the words of Christ dwell in you. So why pray? Is he just adding one more thing to our ever-growing to-do list? No, that's not why Paul instructs us here to pray. Today, my prayer, my hope is that we see that as the Holy Spirit is the heartbeat that gives life to our spiritual strength, that as the Bible is the nourishment to our spiritual strength, prayer should be like the breath that we need in order to remain alive. Martin Luther is a reformer in the church. He once said, "To be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing." Lifeway is a Christian bookstore throughout the nation, throughout the world. It's part of the Southern Baptist Convention. Lifeway recently released some statistics about prayer, and they show that 78% of those who were surveyed, that they find themselves praying during the day at the spur of the moment. I read that statistic and thought, that's a pretty good statistic, right? 78% pray at the spur of the moment throughout the day. It shows that even in American Christianity, throughout the busyness of our lives, that there's a mindset of prayer. Jesus himself did this. There were times that at the spur of the moment, or spontaneously, Jesus would pray, whether it was feeding 5,000 people plus with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, or whether it was just a spontaneous prayer and giving thanks to God. But Lifeway also showed the statistics that 2 in 5 churchgoers say that they set time aside for prayer. So while spur of the moment praying is good, and I believe it's something that I want to encourage, today I want to focus on that intentional, that purposeful time that is set aside to pray. We learned that Daniel did it in the Old Testament. Daniel chapter 6, verse 10 says that Daniel prayed 3 times a day on his knees talking to God. Peter did it. We learned in Acts that Peter got up on the rooftop at noon and he prayed. Jesus did it. The very first chapter in Mark, one of the very first things that Mark wants us to see is that Jesus devoted himself to prayer. Mark said, "Rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, departing and going to a desolate place to pray." Just as I've encouraged you, and I hope you have already, that you've set aside a specific place and a specific time to read the words of Christ, to read the Bible, my prayer is that you will set aside a time and a place for purposeful prayer. Jesus said in John 15, 7, Jesus said these words, "If you abide in me," which I believe he's speaking of the preeminence of Christ. He said, "If you abide in me and if my words abide in you," which again goes back to Colossians, "let the words of Christ dwell richly in you." Jesus said, "Ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. And by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit." So, as we surrender our life to the rule of Jesus in our daily routine, in our daily life, and as you allow the words of Christ to dwell richly in you, set aside time in a specific place to communicate with God through prayer. Let me give you, this is just something from my personal daily walk with the Lord. I do this in the mornings. I'm not saying you have to do this in the mornings, but this is how I do it. I do my personal time. I have a set place. I have a set time in the mornings. It's a little bit quieter in the mornings. And I combine my prayer and Bible reading time together. So I sit down and I read the Word of God. I read His Word, then I take a verse or a passage, and then I have a journal. This is the type of journal I have. And then I write down a verse or a passage in my journal, and I use that thought, that focus from God's Word, and I use that as a way to pray. It's not the only time, though. There are times that during the day I may come in here in the sanctuary, and I may walk through the pews, and I may pray for you. You know, it's one advantage of being a Southern Baptist and not changing where you sit each Sunday. I know where you sit. Okay, so I can go through the pew and I can say, hey, I know that they've sat here for the past 4 years, at least since I've been here. I don't say that. But I do know where you sit. Praise the Lord for that. Because again, that's an advantage. I can walk through and I can pray for you. I go through the Sunday school classes and pray for you as well. There's a way that you can pray. This is something that I've implemented in my life, and it's the praying the acronym ACTS. A-C-T-S. The first letter, A, adoration. So starting out my prayer, adoring God for who He is. So I tell God something from the Bible, something I learned in my quiet time, and I say, God, I adore You for being sovereign King of the universe, that You invite us to pray. The next letter, C, confession. I spend time confessing my sin before God. God knows my sin. He knows my heart already, but He invites me. He welcomes me to confess this before Him in prayer. And then the next letter, T, is thanksgiving. I give God thanks for what He's doing in my life, for what He's doing in our church life, or in the life of my family, or something that I read in His Word. And then finally, S, supplication. That's where I ask God on behalf of our church or something in need in my life or in my family life or in the community or throughout the world. Look, there are other methods that you can use to pray, but this is one I thought would be easy to remember since we just went through the book of Acts last year. But we can't overlook here in Colossians chapter 4, verse 2, to whom Paul was writing this passage. Paul is writing this passage to a congregation of believers at Colossae. And while individual prayer is important and necessary and vital in our walk with God, so is prayer with each other important and vital in your spiritual growth. For our church family, we pray during the service. I don't know if you noticed, but in the 40, 50 minutes that we've been here thus far, we've prayed three different times here in our service. For those who come to Sunday school, you pray in your Sunday school class. Another time that we have an opportunity to pray together as a church family to continue steadfastly in prayer is on Sunday evenings at 5:30. We gather here in the sanctuary, and during this precious time, we give God praise for what He's doing. So we stop, and right at the beginning, we share what God's doing with one another. And then we stop, and we spend time silently, right in our seat, confessing before God our sin. And then we take some time after that, and we share requests with one another. We've got a printed list. At the same time, we share maybe something that needs to be added to that list. And then we spend time praying for the needs that are on the list, for the ministries, for the different opportunities in our community, in our church, and throughout the world. And I may call on our deacons and ask them to pray, but otherwise, it's up to you how you feel the Spirit leading you to pray out loud or silently at your seat. And our church is blessed on Sunday nights with 20 or more people who gather in spirit to pray for you, to pray for our community, and to pray for the world. Vance Havner, he once said that the thermometer of a church is its prayer meeting. The thermometer of a church is its prayer meeting. So what we see here in Colossians 4:2 is that prayer is not just for your individual time, but it's for those who are a part of our church family as well, those who are members. And today, if you're unable to join us and gather in prayer on Sunday evenings, can I encourage you, set an alarm at 5:30 wherever you're at, if you're at home watching the news or if you're out on the road traveling for work, 5:30. Set an alarm, set something, a reminder, a post-it note on your head to remind you, I'm going to pray for my church family, I'm going to pray for the world, I'm going to pray for our community, that the gospel will go forth. And today, I'm not sharing these things to guilt you into prayer, but I want to share these as an encouragement to pray. There's a man passed away a few years ago. His name was Jerry Falwell. Jerry Falwell is the founder of Liberty University out in Lynchburg, Virginia. Jerry Falwell, while a college student, he found a room at the college that he was attending in the administrative building, and he got a key to that room, and every day, every Monday through Friday, from 1:30 until 5 o'clock, Jerry Falwell went into that room to pray. And he was praying because he was a fifth grade boys Sunday school teacher. Now, I know if you teach children or youth, you may understand why he's praying. But every day, Monday through Friday, from 1:30 until 5 o'clock. By the way, I love our kids, by the way. That wasn't a slam against kids ministry. Okay, I love our kids. But you'll see the example here. You see what happened. When he started that prayer time, he only had two kids in his fifth grade class. And when he stopped teaching, he had 57 kids in that fifth grade class. John Hyde was a missionary to India. And those that he served in India gave him the nickname, the Praying Hyde, because he prayed so much. One year, at the beginning of the year, John Hyde prayed that someone would be saved every single day that year. And he continued to pray that prayer. And by the end of that year, over 400 people had placed their faith in Christ. What did he do? He doubled it the next year. And the Lord answered. Oswald Chambers, many of you may read his devotionals. If not, it's a wonderful devotional. You can find My Utmost for His Highest. But he once wrote, prayer does not equip us for greater works. Prayer is the greater work. Can I read that again? Prayer does not equip us for greater works. Prayer is the greater work. And this leads into the next point I want us to see here in verse 2. Spiritual strength endures with prayer through spiritual alertness. Paul wrote, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it. The word watchful in this passage simply means alert. In other words, be alert in your praying. But it doesn't give you, this doesn't give you the reason to have a cup of coffee in the mornings in your prayer time. Of course, you could use this verse to have coffee because I'm a big fan of coffee. But it's not a physical alertness that Paul's talking about here. This is a spiritual awakeness, a spiritual alertness in his prayer life. Here's an example. Sunday evenings, when we gather to pray, and we always start out with a printed list of needs, but by the end of our time of prayer, that list has grown. Why? Because there's so many needs. There's so many people that need prayer for healing or sickness or different spiritual needs in our community. But if you were to take a look at that list alone, just looking at the list, and as it grows each week, it can become overwhelming. It really can. There's so many needs around us. It's like watching the news. If you were to just focus on watching the news every single evening, and you just focus on what's going on in the world and everything that's happening, it can become not only overwhelming, but possibly depressing. You can become more anxious if you're looking at these things alone. But when we gather for prayer, And when we take that list, the needs before God in prayer, and we lift up the names of those who have cancer, those who are unsaved, the needs in our community, we're quickly reminded as we pray of who God is. We're reminded of His mighty power. We're reminded of His merciful listening ear. So then there's a peace. There's a comfort in knowing that the God who sits on the throne of the universe, He hears our prayers and He will answer in His perfect will and in His perfect wisdom. But how does praying help our spiritual strength endure with spiritual alertness? It helps because when we pray, we're not alone. We're not alone when we pray. Romans 8:27, Paul writes, "The Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." So when you pray, it's not just your thoughts, it's not just your words, but it's the power of the Spirit of God that rose Jesus up from the dead, that lives inside of you, that intercedes for you according to the will of God. So when that situation that you're facing seems overwhelming and the thoughts of defeat just abound in your mind, and when it seems like that even the prayer that you're praying isn't even going past the roof, Paul said in Romans 8:26 that the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us. Today you are in a spiritual battle, and your enemy does not want you to pray. Your enemy does not want our church to pray as often as we do. Your enemy wants you to get discouraged, to get overwhelmed, and to feel defeated. But Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, God's divine power has granted to us all things that pertains to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us to His own glory and excellence. And when we understand that God has given us all that we need to grow spiritually, it leads to the final point I want us to look at today. Colossians 4:2, Paul finishes here. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. So what we see finally today is spiritual strength endures with prayer as God prepares a thankful heart through prayer. I know I've told this before. I'm going to tell it again because I think it's a funny story. And I've been convicted lately, I don't laugh a lot. So I laughed at this story over this past week. So if you've heard it, just bear with me. But it does fit with the point here. There was a monk one time who signed up in a monastery, took a vow of silence, and he was only allowed to speak two words every 10 years. So the first 10 years went by, and the monk came up to his supervisor, and his supervisor said, "Okay, you've got two words. What would you like to say?" And the monk said, "Bed hard." That's all he said, "Bed hard." So the next 10 years went by, and the monk came before his supervisor, and the supervisor said, "Okay, you've got two words. What would you like to say?" The monk said, "Food bad." So the next 10 years went by, and the monk came before his supervisor, and the supervisor said, "Okay, it's been 10 years, you've got two words, what would you like to say?" And the monk said, "I quit." The supervisor looked at him and said, "Well, that doesn't surprise me. You've done nothing but complain since you've been here." Prayerlessness is at the root of thanklessness. Can I say that again? Prayerlessness is at the root of thanklessness. Prayer is communication with the sovereign ruler of the universe and the ruler of all things. You, my friends, and I are able to approach the throne of God Because of the work of Jesus. Because of the life and the death and the resurrection and the work of the Holy Spirit within us, Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." So, with confidence in the work of Jesus, we can approach God's throne and find grace to help us in the time of need. Praise the Lord. Can I ask you then, are you thankful? Are you thankful? As we end our series on spiritual growth, and guys, I'm coming to an end here, I promise. Let's revisit the verse that we've been reading every single Sunday this year, Colossians 2, 6, and 7, and hear that verse as it speaks about thankfulness. Paul said, "Therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were thought, or just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving." A result of spiritual growth is an abundance of thankfulness. It's an abundance of thanksgiving. That's why Ann Steele, the lady I read that quote from at the beginning of the sermon today, that's why Ann Steele could write these words in the middle of all that she faced. "Give me a calm, thankful heart, free from every murmur." What's murmur? Old-fashioned word for complaints. There's a lot we could complain about, right? There's a lot. We could spend half our day complaining. Body aches and pains, right? We can complain about changes in our world. We can stay and complain about the length of sermons, the job you have. We can complain about how COVID's been handled and all of these things. But today, I don't want to place a complaint box up here at the front and invite us, as we dismiss, to submit your complaints before God. Today, I want to invite you to submit your life, to surrender your life to Jesus. Remind yourself, Jesus rules. Jesus rules in my spiritual walk with him. Jesus rules my daily schedule. Jesus rules at my work. He rules in my body. He rules in all things. And submit and surrender your life to the work of the Holy Spirit. So let me ask you, Christian, brothers and sisters in Christ, are you growing as a Christian? If so, if that's you, can I ask you, are you growing with your church family? Are you growing with one another? Are you walking in him? If you would like today to grow in your walk with the Lord, if you would like to grow spiritually and to endure in your spiritual growth today, I want to invite you to pray. And you don't have to pray here at the altar. Of course, I do invite you to. You can pray at your seat. You can pray at home when you go home today. And you can ask God for strength to endure in your spiritual growth. And today, if you're not a Christian, and as you look around the room, you're not going to see a group of perfect people. As a matter of fact, if you were to look around the room, you're going to see broken people. But the difference is, you're going to see a group of broken people that have recognized our brokenness and have cried out to Jesus to be rescued from the brokenness. So today, if you recognize and realize that you are broken, today I want to tell you how you can be rescued. The Bible says that Jesus came to this earth and Jesus lived perfectly. Yet Jesus, even though he was perfect, he died on the cross. He was nailed to a cross. And he took our sin, our brokenness, and Jesus became broken for us. And on the cross, Jesus died. But on the third day, Jesus defeated sin by coming back to life again. And now, because Jesus is alive, the Bible says that when you place your faith in Jesus and in his work, in other words, you place your confidence in the work of Jesus, the Bible says you will be saved. So if you're not a Christian, that's my invitation for you. Will you bow your head with me today as we pray? Father, once more, we come before your throne with confidence, asking for grace to help us in our time of need. Father, maybe there are some here today who have needs in their life. Maybe they want to grow spiritually. They've been trying on their own strength, but God, I pray that you will help them realize today that you've given us prayer. God, may today be the start and the transformation in the prayer lives of your people. And God, I pray today, Father, that you would, if there's someone here today that's not a Christian, that you will open their eyes, help them see their need of you, help them see the brokenness that's within, that the brokenness won't be fixed with their methods, the things that they see, but rather the brokenness can be redeemed, that they can be rescued by placing their confidence and trust in the work of Christ, your Son. And it's in the power and the authority of his name we pray. Amen. All right, let's stand. The invitation has begun. How will you respond?
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God. Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark lot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God. Just as I am, I would be lost, but mercy and grace my freedom bought, and now to glory in your cross, O Lamb of God. I come empty to be filled, and I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb, and I'm welcomed with open arms, praise God, just as I am, praise God, just as I am.
All right, praise the Lord. You may be seated. Hey, let's talk about some ways that you can continue to make God's name great here at First Baptist Church. Tonight, again at 5:30, we're going to have prayer meeting here in the sanctuary, and it's an invitation for all of you all to come. Tonight, we're going to have a special emphasized prayer meeting. I'll get it right later. We're going to have a special prayer meeting tonight for our children, for our youth here in our community. So it's open invitation for everybody tonight to come out to pray for our community, for our children, for our youth here in our communities. So this is for families of all ages. So that's tonight at 5:30 here in the sanctuary. Andy and Vanessa will be leading that, so hope to see you tonight. Family Fuel Night is back in each Wednesday from 6 to 7. Here in the church facility, we have children and youth activities. That's every Wednesday from 6 until 7. Ladies' Bible studies and men's Bible studies continue on. Ladies, this Tuesday evening is Jen Foote's study that she will be looking at called Seamless by Angie Smith. That will start at 7. And then Thursday evening, for those who are studying with Alyssa, that will be 7 o'clock as you'll study the Minor Prophets. Men's Bible studies every Wednesday morning, 6:30, here in the fellowship hall. In the 2x2 room, you can gather to study God's Word. We're currently studying 1 Timothy. And there will also be coming soon, in a few weeks, Lord's willing, another men's study called Soul Con. So be looking out for more information about that. And at this time, I'm going to ask Doug DeVore to come up. He's our missions vice president. He's going to talk about what we see up here on the stage after Doug's finished, and our deacon of the week, James Cutchin, will pray for us.
Thank you very much. I just want to remind you of the mission opportunity that we have, that we are participating in, and that's raising money for the local crisis pregnancy center, which is called the Pregnancy Help Center. And you can do that one of two ways. One, we have some baby bottles that are left over. You can take those, put your offering in there, and bring it back and put it in this baby crib up here. And the last day to do that is February the 13th. That clap is because I have messed this up 2 weeks in a row. So this is my last chance to get it right. It is February the 13th. If you make sure you bring that in by that date, and then we will get it to the Pregnancy Center. You can write your checks payable to the Pregnancy Help Center, or you can make them payable to First Baptist Church, and we will get that money sent to the Pregnancy Help Center. The other way you can do it is we're collecting diapers as well. The Children's Department and the Youth Department are already involved in that, and this may be some of the fruits of their labor. But they're collecting diapers. You can do that as well, and they need newborns size 3, 4, and 5. So get involved in this mission project. It's a local mission to care for the unborn, and I encourage you to do that. So thank you very much.
Father, we again thank you for this church. We thank you for what it means in each of our lives as well as the life of this community. Lord, we pray that you would go with us this week, that others would see you through us, and that you would bring us safely back together. I ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful.